coming up, a new charge controller is on its way, so we put our modular connections to good use and wire up some XT60 connectors. Then we'll do an overall cost breakdown. In the previous video, we repaired overvoltage damage on our inverter and a burnt track on our soon-to-be-replaced charge controller. It's currently running, but it will be set aside for temporary battery charging use in the future. Now onto the connectors for our new charge controller. Here I've got a plug and socket together, making sure to put the right one pointing up. Having both together helps sap away heat and keep everything where it's supposed to be. This job was made so much easier by this rusty old vise, which I really should have restored before using. I highly recommend a heavy mini vise as a third hand. It's not going anywhere. Perhaps I can do a future video where I clean this up, paint it and 3D print some plastic jaws. I'm reusing cable from old busted solar panels. It was both the right gauge for these plugs and it was free. Hardback razor blade is the way to go, cutting through the insulation. These plugs are solder on. In this kind of application, the more flux the better. Next, some electrical tape. Then heat shrink. And finally, some more heat shrink. Times that by two, one quick disconnect plug for the solar panel side and one for the battery side.
The next day.
And here we have it, the Renogy Rover 40 amp charge controller. First impressions, it's heavy and it looks good. On the bottom we have a temperature connector which you would use with lead acid batteries, photovoltaic in, battery out, DC load terminals. These are not for your inverter, they are for small loads like lights that can be turned on and off according to a schedule, and an RS232 port which is where the Bluetooth module plugs in. Let's have a look inside. These terminals are rock solid. The main board is coated with lacquer or conformal coating. This helps prolong its life, preventing corrosion due to humidity. It's got massive inductors. Nice heavy cables. Let's get a look at those capacitors. A bit hard to see. 330 microfarad 100 volt on the input, so you won't want to be exceeding 100 volt with your solar panel strings. If you buy the Rover 60, it can go up to 150 volts. And 1000 microfarad 63 volt on the output side. The main thing I wanted to check was how safe those wire ends are from touching each other. And as you can see, they've got that covered. Thank you. Okay, let's connect those leads I made yesterday and mount it on the wall. These screw terminals are fantastic. Could give it a bit and it's not going to break. There's our connectors. Obviously you need some common sense when plugging things in. Huge passively cooled heatsink, not a noisy fan in sight. Mounting options. I went with the little brackets and screwed it onto the wall. Because I made the XT60 leads, it all just plugs in. Here's the Bluetooth module. The only negative with this unit over the old green one is the awful Game & Watch type interface. You need to look up the manual to figure this one out. Fortunately, there is the Renogy DC Home app. You can see the state of charge, current solar panel voltage, amps, watts, battery voltage, charging current, charge controller temperature. Keep in mind the battery temperature is not connected as we're not pulling big loads. That's more necessary for lead acid battery charging. And of course we have the total energy produced, 60 kilowatt hours. This has only been running a small fridge or refrigerator for 4.5 months. I haven't even got around to connecting up lights and power outlets. However, I do have some interesting plans for making full use of the generated power. Let's have a look at the settings. We've got options for 12 or 24 volts. Battery type. There are no advanced parameters for lithium. We'd love to see them add some options in here like charge cutoff voltage. The user option is only for lead acid type batteries. Let's have a quick look at the DC load options. They've got no use for most users as you can access your DC load directly from the battery. And data logging. It keeps a full history of everything that's happened. As you can see, it's been over-discharged 13 times. This is mostly due to me removing one battery for a whole month and also a few overcast days. You can see the low voltage log, 9.6 volts. The month before it went down to 9. For the final cost breakdown, keep in mind this is a DIY solar installation. It's 12 volt off-grid. You can use the same products in a four-wheel drive, a van, a cabin or a boat, but you won't be grid connecting any of this. Obviously I'm not including the previous charge controller or any mistakes. Lessons learned, you can't cheap out on everything. Prices are approximate in Australian dollars as of December 2022. First up, the 6 used solar panels I got on Facebook Marketplace for $200. Used panels are the easiest way to save money. Next, the Renogy Rover 40 amp MPPT solar charge controller with Bluetooth module. It was $200. You can save $30 buying it without the Bluetooth module, but I believe it's money well spent keeping track of your kilowatt hour usage, any low voltage shutdowns or other issues which may arise. Another $160 will get you the 60 amp version. Next we have two no brand 100 amp hour lithium iron phosphate batteries, biggest expense at $758. These are about half the cost of brand name batteries, so I consider it a very good deal. You can cut costs by buying one battery first, but I highly recommend having two as a buffer for cloudy days. If you want maximum reliability, this is where you need to buy four or more. Next is the Pure Sine Wave inverter. I bought this years ago and it sat unused. A similar inverter is about $100. 1 kilowatt will charge your phones, run a fridge, computer and your TV, but won't run high current appliances. I recommend 3 kilowatt, 6 kilowatt peak if you want to run a washing machine, electric jug or hot plate, but you still won't be running all three at once. Solar panel 2-into-1 or Y connectors, they are cheap at $8. I've only included the one pair. It's coming into winter here and I'll need to install the other 4 panels, so I might need to buy another 2 pairs and some extra cable depending on the series parallel configuration. cable to go from the charge controller to the batteries. I got twin pair, I forget how many amps it was. I got it from a local battery and solar shop and just asked them what they recommend. It was inexpensive at about $5 a meter or $20. Finally, the XT60 connectors, 5 pairs are cheap at $8. You can go XT90 if you like, I've had no trouble with the 60 amp ones. I wouldn't recommend putting any connector between the battery and inverter. Remember, these double up as a switch, you can quickly unplug or even reconfigure with ease. Our total all up is $1,294 Australian dollars, or about $900 US. Links for the above products are in the description. I'm going to leave this here. I'm not a fan of long drawn out videos. If you found this entertaining or informative, be sure to like and subscribe. Leave a comment if you've got any questions, and check the description for further information. I've got more to come with this particular solar setup. Thanks for watching.